And tonight, I'm going to jump right into the introductions because I really have been anticipating this night on substance abuse. This is a complex issue, and I have so many questions. And we are really, really privileged to have some of the most gifted speakers, teachers, scholars with us tonight who can really speak to this topic in an informed way that is also theologically grounded. So I just wanna start. Joyce Ann Mercer is a scholar, researcher, teacher, writer, retreat leader, and professor of practical theology here at Yale Divinity School. Professor Joyce joined the YDS faculty as a professor of pastoral care and practical theology in 2016 after 10 years at Virginia Theological Seminary as the Arthur Lee Consiving Chair in Pastoral and Practical Theology. Dr. Mercer has also served on faculties at the Graduate Theological Union and Union Theological Seminary in the Philippines. Her career includes positions in chaplaincy and clinical social work in Atlanta, St. Paul, and Minneapolis. Further, as a licensed clinical social worker, she also has a wealth of experience in community-based healthcare and addictions. Joyce Ann Mercer's work focuses on practices of care in diverse contexts and situations, including post-conflict areas of Southeast Asia, children and consumer culture of the U.S., addictions and family systems, and the religious lives of adolescent girls. And if you didn't already know, the practical theological thread running throughout her work is the fostering of liberatory hope, where personal and social forms of suffering limit human flourishing. Professor Mercer's current project is based on a congregational study of churches in conflict with their denominations over sexuality. She recently edited Conundrums in Practical Theology, and some of her earlier works include Welcoming Children, A Practical Theology of Childhood, Girl Talk, God Talk, Why Faith Matters to Teenage Girls and Their Parents, Lives to Offer, Accompanying Youth on Their Vocational Quest. Her passions include advocacy and welcome of children in the church and beyond, exploring women's religious experience, older adult ministries, the spirituality of adolescent girls, studying congregations, and I could go on and on. She is also an ordained minister or a teaching elder in the Presbyterian Church. And I thought this was really interesting. In a blog she wrote on faith formation, best teaching practices with children and youth, she really gives some insight into the faith formation of young people. And so if you were to ask Joyce, what's the best curriculum for forming children and youth in Christian faith? This is what she would say, and I quote, "We invite people into the way of life that embodies God's love, justice, compassion, and reconciliation by being, doing, and thinking about it together. The best curriculum for forming children, youth, and anyone else in the Christian faith is guided participation in a community of practice where people are vibrantly, passionately risking themselves together in lives of faith in a world crying out for the love of Christ," end quote. But what I admire most about Dr. Mercer is her ability to bring so many disciplines together in her scholarship. As a former social worker, a Christian educator, and a scholar of pastoral care, not to mention a feminist and social justice advocate, she has a way of bringing such insight and wisdom to the conversation. On a personal note, Joyce Mercer is not only a brilliant colleague, she is also a gracious and compassionate colleague. On more than one occasion, Dr. Mercer has found time in her busy schedule to cook, bring meals over for my family, and sit with me during some of the most triumphant times, like the birth of my daughter, and most difficult times, like the death of my mother. In other words, her theology spills over into her life, and so I'm truly honored that she agreed to be part of this lecture series. With her is a dear friend as well, Reverend Charles Edward Atkins, Jr. Reverend Atkins' work focuses on religious practice in incarcerated communities. Charles has an MDiv and an MA in Christian education from Princeton Theological Seminary and is at the very last stage of his work as a PhD candidate at the University of Montreal. Charles is an ordained minister who currently works as a full-time chaplain with the New Jersey Department of Corrections at the Garden State Youth Correctional Facility, where, over the last 20 years, he has developed and maintained programs that teach incarcerated youth and young adults methods of overcoming inner and outer violence through the practical application of spiritual principles. His work in prison was featured by the World Vision Report in November 2017 and in the nationally distributed Harvard Ferd College Alumni Magazine. In 2015, with a working group on religious education in prisons, Charles was able to organize an international conference on religious education in prisons at the University of Montreal that invited educators from the United States and Canada, which is also where I first met him. Since Charles is trilingual, speaking English, French fluently, and Spanish proficiently, he has worked for the spiritual empowerment and socioeconomic development of people in Central America, Africa, Europe, and the Caribbean. He is also very interested in the challenges to religious practice of immigrants in their adopted countries. Atkins currently serves as a part-time preacher and worship leader for the French Evangelical Church of New York, where he helps this fellowship in Manhattan to strengthen their French worship service and their outreach to French-speaking people. Having once been an artist in the hip-hop music industry, Charles continues to enjoy producing music. He has produced music to support a campaign to raise awareness of child endangerment. And if you don't know, he has a pretty famous album, Snatch Back Hope, which is a grouping of spoken word poetry and hip hop music. Charles has a wife, Margaret, and three children, and actually a very young one. But what I love most about Charles is his authenticity, his ability to be down to earth, his faith, and the ability of his scholarship to touch the ground. Would you join me in welcoming our two guests for tonight?
My goal is to become the person Sarah Farmer thinks I am. Good evening.
Me too.
So, why are we here? We are here for a conversation about substance use and abuse as an inhibitor to joy, a barrier to joy.
Why we're here, we should also talk to you about, because, well, this is not an abstract topic for either myself or for Joyce. People we love, communities we care about and serve, have dealt with this subject of substance use and abuse. We're here for who we love, for who we care about, mm-hmm. for who we're connected to.
I have close, immediate family who are struggling with substance abuse, and their everyday lives are ravaged by the effects of drug addiction on their ability to flourish. Other family members, my extended family, have died from the consequences and effects of substance abuse and addiction. And other family members still, most notably my amazing sister, live very full and flourishing lives as recovering people, my sister and others. My own ministry background, working in chaplaincy in an adolescent drug treatment center, where I was providing pastoral care and walking alongside addicted young people, some of whom were as young as 12 years old. And so I've been seeing this, watching it take on different forms in the culture over a long period of time now, and working as a clinical social worker in street clinic for teenagers, lots of the kids who would come in search of medical services also had underlying issues with substance abuse or use or addictions. And of course, as a parish pastor, plenty of occasions to experience the way that addiction interrupted and made complicated and difficult lives in families, particularly families of youth in the church, but also in the congregation at large. Here at Yale Divinity School, I teach and write and do research also on substance abuse as one of the things that I care about, because it matters to me to strengthen the capacities of the people who are going to be doing ministry with those folks who are in congregations and who are not in congregations but need to know our care.
I'm also from a situation where, hey, I dealt with it in my family. I remember from being 7 years old when I had an uncle who dealt with the reality of the networks that surround those that abuse certain substances, whether it be alcohol or drugs, and one of those people in his circles killed him. And I remember seeing my younger cousins having to grow up and deal with what I have seen over and over again working in the corrections system for the last 20 years about young men who grew up without their fathers and what that means. I have seen myself and worked with others trying to deal with the ripple effects of substance use, substance abuse. But I gotta thank you all for being here, really. You caring about young people remind me of Deacon Beverly. He was the deacon that reached out to me when my uncle died, and he became my first mentor, not only in the faith, but in life. So thank you for being here. Well, now we need to deal with why you're here. Get used to this. I mean, we're going to ask you all to talk to each other. I mean, it's at the end of the week. Y'all know each other already. So we would like for you to just take a minute to share, if you don't know already, names at tables. Some of you may have come together, others you may not know. But we'd like for you to not only share your names, but just give one sentence as to your reason for being here tonight. Would you please?
And see how they're getting around so we know when to break in. Some of you have more people at your tables, so it takes a little longer to get around. Take just a minute and finish up. We're not going to ask you to share that out, but I do want to ask you a few questions. Would you raise your hand if there is somebody in your life, somebody that you know, who is experiencing negative consequences in their life because of substance abuse, and you're aware of them. Doesn't have to be somebody in your youth group, doesn't have to be somebody in your family, just somebody you know, all right? How many of you know a young person who is having trouble with substance abuse issues? How many of you know a young person who is dealing with the addiction issues of their parents? That's a pretty large number. How many of us in this room know somebody who has died of an opioid overdose? I want you to look at that for a minute. It's very sobering, yes?
Bless you.
Okay, so we are assuming that, like us, you also do not have an abstract relationship to this topic because people you care about are affected by this topic. And I think we should also assume that within this room, some of us are in recovery ourselves. Some of us come from families with people in recovery. Some of us are adult children of alcoholic parents. Some of us know or are very involved in the lives of young people for whom these are living, real issues. We are part of communities that are ravaged by substance abuse. And that means we all come with our own histories, our own attitudes, our own experiences in relation to the topic. So we want to set a few guidelines as we begin to talk about this, because we understand that this can be a sensitive topic, that you don't go into a conversation like this expecting that nobody here is going to feel anything or that no issues will come up for anyone here. Nevertheless, let me be clear. This evening, we are not having a therapy session, okay? You can't afford me for this many people, so we're not going to do that. But here are some agreements that I think it will be helpful if we can make together. The first one is for each one of us here to take ownership of our own stories. That is, take your own story and the words you speak as your story and recognize that not everybody has that same story, even if we're talking about the same thing. A second would be to honor the stories and the speaking of others. That means, in part, let it stay here. Let it stay here. Meaning, what somebody feels comfortable sharing with you at their table, they may not want to have on the prayer chain tomorrow, right? So let it stay here. Unless, of course, you're concerned that someone is in danger, either to themselves or to someone else. And, of course, that's when we don't keep things private in that way. Another is for us to just be learners together, to be open. There are no dumb questions. We come to this topic from different starting points and different experiences of awareness and education, and that's good. And the last one is probably the most important one. Trust God. Trust that God is at work in this place. Trust Amen. That God is present among us and with us while we deal with this very difficult, very complicated topic. Trust that God cares about the young people that you are working with even more than you do. And that's a lot. Trust God.
So just in terms of a roadmap, just so you know where we're going, we're going to deal with, we've dealt with our introductions, we've dealt with who we are, why we are here. We're going to be dealing with substance abuse as a barrier of
Joy.
And we're going to deal with it, first of all, by sharing the stories of the lives of two young people that we have come across in our work. And then we'll be dealing with issues like the difference between what is an ordinary teenager versus a substance abuser, right? Some of us, including me, have been confused about that. Then we'll talk about our brains. I mean, this is an issue dealing with our brains. This is a chemical situation. Neuroscience is at work. We'll deal with the social contexts for substance abuse. And then, of course, why does this matter? Why does this all matter? Why does all this information matter to your youth ministry? And then we'll try to jump into, if we have time, I think we will, to jump into one part of the curriculum that we're offering as a part of this series, So you can really see how you can engage young people around this subject in your context. Well, say amen if you read this psalm before. You cause the grass to grow for the cattle, and plants for people to use, to bring forth food from the earth and wine to gladden the human heart. What about this one? Wine is a mocker, strong drink a brawler, and whoever is led astray by it is not wise.
So which is it, Charles? Is wine a mocker, or is wine gladdening the human heart?
That's a good question.
Yeah, there you go. That's
both.
Why it's so complicated. And religious organizations have a sad history on this topic of condemning and judging people who are struggling with substance abuse, of not approaching people who struggle with these issues with care and compassion, not knowing how to do that, and seeing addiction as a moral failure or as a lack of willpower. And while there are many contested theories about substance abuse, and the jury is still out, there's not one definitive understanding of this, there is pretty wide acceptance of the idea that a substance abuse disorder or an addiction is a chronic brain condition. It is related to changes that happen in the pathways in our brains. So how about a little snapshot of what this looks like among American youth today? We know, for instance, that in 2016 alone, a lot of young people, 4,110 young people, died in the United States as a result of opioid overdoses. Motor vehicle accidents are the leading cause of death among youth, and alcohol has a role in about half of these deaths. Of the 2.4 million young people, 17 and under, who are involved with the juvenile justice system, a full 78%, or 1.9 million, have some connection with substance abuse as a part of that situation. And guess what? The very best predictor that an adult is going to have a substance abuse disorder and addiction in their adulthood is that they start using drugs as a teenager.
In spite of the recognition of these issues, for some reason, substance abuse remains a very important topic missing from a lot of youth ministries. This is not just a public health issue, but a theological one, an issue that recognizes substance abuse as an inhibitor of joy, even though it mirrors the experience of joy on a cellular level, it sets up youth to seek false fulfillment of their desires for joy. Substance abuse creates fake joy. In doing so, it ushers young people into inauthentic identities, inauthentic relationships, inauthentic life projects.
So we want you to take a look at a 2-minute video that says a little bit of an introduction to this topic by answering the question, what is addiction?
It's a disease. A disease like any other.
Addiction is a disease. It's a brain condition that involves compulsive use of a substance.
And it's essential that the family remembers that the addict is not making these decisions. They're being driven by the addiction itself.
It isn't a moral failing. It really is a health issue driven by that choice and losing control of the choice.
Addicts look like you and me. There is no typical addict.
Having a diagnosable condition related to alcohol or drugs is present in about 22 million Americans in any given year.
Science has really advanced, revealing how these substances affect the brain. Two parts of the brain are involved, the limbic system that drives the behavior and the frontal lobes that should stop the behavior, but it isn't working right.
People who are at risk of becoming addicts have differences in this brain system that may explain their responses to substances and why some people go on to develop addiction and others don't.
In early addiction, people are using and maybe getting in a little bit of trouble, but in later addiction, they may risk their lives to continue the use of the substance, or they've lost everything.
Adolescent addiction is a particularly serious issue because we're worried about not only the addiction and how to treat that and how to help these kids get back to normal, but we worry particularly about the real exposure to drugs at such an early age when their brain is still developing.
90% of all adults with an addiction began their use in their teenage years. So when you think about addiction, think about it as an adolescent health issue.
The most important advice I can think of for a family that's going through addiction would be to remember that this is a disease.
I have an addiction.
They're not weak.
I have a disease.
So we want you to take a minute at your tables again and just talk a little about what stands out to you so far in this discussion of substance abuse and youth. What did you see here that stands out, what relates perhaps to your own situation for ministry? Just take a minute for some table talk. I took your line because you were busy.
All right, we know it's getting deep. We're going to ask you to come back to the group. Sharing testimonies is so important to this process, so important to try and wrestling with this topic. We would like to share with you right now a couple of testimonies that we have come across in our work. I'd like to talk to you about a young man I met during my work in prison in New Jersey. I'll call him Anthony. Anthony is an African-American who grew up in an area in southern New Jersey that may not be considered a poor environment, yet the area has more than its share of impoverished families. Anthony was a promising football running back who, like most teens, he sought friends, especially since his parents split up when he was a toddler and his stepfather became as distant as his biological father. He gained popularity in school by using and supplying marijuana and mixtapes to his friends at school. At the age of 16, one night, he and his core group of friends were joined by another teenager that Anthony did not know, a friend of a friend. After passing the evening getting high, they got hungry. With little to no money, someone suggests that they order Chinese food for delivery, then steal the food and the delivery man's money. Since the new associate who had come to the group had a gun, they figured it would be easy. They ordered the food and the delivery man arrived in the parking lot of the apartment complex where the boys were hiding in ambush. They surprised him, took the money, and ran back to their apartment in a neighboring apartment complex. This friend of a friend, however, stayed behind. For whatever reason, shot and killed the delivery man. Anthony and his core friends were oblivious of this until, while eating the food, the police did a sweep of the apartment complex on a tip and found him and his friends, and his mind, cloudy from the drugs, became clear. After he was arrested and placed in a police car, and as the car drove away, he saw the body of the delivery man being put into an ambulance with a woman crying over him. At that point, Anthony realized that his situation was a lot more serious than he had imagined. Of course, the prosecutor lumped Anthony up with all the guys together. And because Anthony's family did not have money for a lawyer, they had to deal with a public defender who was only able to negotiate for him a 17-year sentence. Young man who had never been arrested or incarcerated before this, 17 years. Anthony and his friends were teens who reinforced their friendships with substance abuse. Their clouded judgment led them into a criminal justice system that systematically sweeps away African-American males and other people of color who have limited education, little financial resources, and minimal legal knowledge. I cannot say that Anthony would not have been arrested if he did not use marijuana with his friends. The social forces that led him to his long sentence are certainly, as we know, more complex, as many researchers have noted. Nevertheless, for the sake of tonight, we need to note that drug use played an important role in his life that fateful night. And the data shows that drugs play an important role in many crimes that occur on many nights in America. That's Anthony.
Let me tell you a different kind of story about a young man as well, Zach, a Euro-American male, a junior in high school, a star on the school's wrestling team. In the regional trials leading up to the state meet, Zach suffered a severe and very painful right knee injury. The road to recovery was very slow. It involved surgery, several surgeries, lots of physical therapy, and a period of impaired mobility. The time after the injury was also socially and emotionally painful for Zach, as he could not be among his teammates competing in the state meet, and he could not enjoy the status that he enjoyed of being a successful member of an athletic team in the final semester. Right after that injury, after the surgery, Zach's doctor prescribed a very strong pain medication because Zach was in a lot of pain. That pain medication, OxyContin, was prescribed to Zach, and even when the physical pain diminished, the pills seemed to help Zach deal with the other kinds of pain that he was experiencing. So without thinking about it explicitly, he just began taking another one now and then when he felt like it. And it made him feel less agitated about all that he was missing out on. For long, though, Zach began to experience cravings for the pills when he had not taken one for a while. He started cutting back on other activities in his life and the relationships that he had been enjoying with friends, and spending more and more of his time with other friends who were using, selling opioids. When Zach gave explanations to his family, they seemed convincing. They seemed logical. His dad would say, "Yeah, all teenagers are moody. They all like to spend time alone in their rooms with the door closed. What are we to do? This is just teenage stuff." After a while, Zach found it easier and cheaper to obtain street drugs than pills. So he began to buy other forms of opiates, such as heroin, to answer the cravings that he was experiencing. Everybody was shocked when the news came that Zach died one night from an overdose of heroin laced with fentanyl on the eve of his 17th birthday. What are some of the reasons that teenagers use substances? What we hear in these two stories are a cluster of reasons. Not every one applies to every person, but let's just think about them together for a minute. They use drugs because they acted on an impulse, like Anthony. Because part of their brain, the part of their brain in charge with putting the brakes on the actions that are too risky, those parts of the brain not even fully developed in adolescence. And so it's easy to act on an impulse without thought to the possible consequences. They use drugs because it felt good, like in Zach's situation. Because drugs also begin to activate the dopamine reward system of the brain, which we'll talk about some more soon. They use drugs as a social lubricant, a way to be with other people. And heaven only knows we need ways, because sometimes it can be hard to connect with people in a world where rejection is right around the corner, because you're always too thin, too fat, too smart, not smart enough, too poor, too awkward, too gay, too freckled, too whatever. You're always something that is a source of rejection, potentially. In some cases, experimenting with substances scratches an itch that teenagers don't even know they have. Put into their lives developmentally as an adolescent, developmentally based hunger for novelty and intensity in experience. For more than one young person I've known, and Charles too, substance use provides a means of self-medication from emotional and other problems that are going on. But what we really want to talk about here, this is an intensely theological issue. All of these young people are, on some level, using drugs because they have a deep, longing, yearning desire. The crucial pulse of human being that invigorates life, that fuels and energizes the connections that we make with one another and with the holy, this desire becomes distorted. This desire seeks satiation from something that is less than full, flourishing life grounded in joy. What is joy, anyway? When we talk about joy in this context, we mean a life orientation, a way of being in the world, an in-touchness with a source of life and with the deep satisfaction that comes from the knowledge of being beloved, of being fully and unreservedly welcomed by God. It's an inner disposition. It orients a way of being in the world. Joy is akin to grace. It is a mysterious inner river of knowledge that God has made right all that is not right about us, and therefore we can flow through our living out of that knowledge. The presence of joy, like the presence of grace, tends to show up in certain concrete actions and attitudes in everyday life, although it can never be reduced to these alone, so it shouldn't be confused with being happy all the time, right? Instead, it is deeper than that. It is a fruit of the Spirit, according to Paul. It's a gift of God. It's God's deep desire for us, even as it is our ultimate response to God's intentions for our flourishing. What that really means is that joy is our vocation. As Christians, we are called to joy. We are invited to live lives of joy. We are equipped to be people of joy. And that is all tangled up with desire. Some people think desire is a bad word, you know, because it shows up in seedy movies and you know, romance novels and other places, and it, you know, it doesn't sound like it's anything holy. Desire is something that God puts in us that acts like a kind of internal homing beacon. It keeps us yearning, it keeps us hungry, it keeps us wanting, it keeps us searching, and ultimately it keeps us longing for God. And so it continually calls us home, that we are restless all the time, as St. Augustine said. Our hearts are restless until we find our rest in you. This desire, this deep longing, this yearning, that's part of our call to joy.
Believe it or not, there is a downside to joy. Paradoxically, joy has as an existential state in which we are fully awake and attuned to life and can rest in the knowledge of God's welcome. God's welcome of us. Also, that joy brings with it a certain restlessness. That is because the existence of joy as a human possibility issues in the built-in desire to find joy. And desire is inherently uncomfortable. Desire wells up like a fire that needs to be extinguished or a longing that must be answered. I'm waking up and I want to be joyful today. You ever heard people say, I'm not going to let you take my joy. Can't take my joy. I'm going to get up, I'm going to get it, I'm going to keep it. It is a goal every day. And that is precisely where substance abuse and addictions come into play. The restless desire that I'm talking about, that joy engenders, makes people, especially young people, vulnerable to attempts to fulfill it by various other available means. When human beings try to satisfy the inherent longing for joy with something that is less than joy, over time, the very ability to recognize and experience authentic joy can become distorted. The internal homing device that she was talking about of our desires can be malformed to seek only that which can put an end to the yearning. To the yearning for joy, regardless of the object to which this joy, this desire is attached. We can be led in this world to experiences of fake joy.
Substance use and abuse complicates the picture even further, though, because not only does it intensify our desires, our compulsions, our wish to get rid of that feeling of yearning restlessness, but substances can masquerade as both objects and sources of real joy in some rather convincing ways. When human beings seek to quench desire and induce joy by abusing substances, over time, real joy becomes unrecognizable. People become unable to tell the difference between fake joy and genuine joy. Substance abusing youth end up putting their efforts and their energy into something that cannot ultimately fulfill that hunger inside of them. And A large part of the faith-related theological problem with the abuse of alcohol or other drugs by young people is that doing that stands in the way of a genuine encounter with the excessive, outrageous, abundant, fully awake, fully alive experience of human flourishing that we mark our lives through lives of joy. Substance abuse can cause young people to stop searching for joy and the source of joy altogether, convinced on some level that the superficial thing they have already found is joy.
So let's deal with some definitions, shall we? We're talking about substance use, substance abuse. Let's break that down just a little bit. Is that okay? Can we break it down just a little bit? Substance, in relation to alcohol and other substances or drug use, a substance is something that a person can use to alter their mood and or state of consciousness. Oh, we got to sit for a little bit. A substance is something that a person can use to alter their mood and or state of consciousness. How many people had some coffee this morning? Yeah, see? That's what it is. Marijuana, like, we know about that. That produces that state of relaxedness, you know? But now there's substances and then there's substance abuse. Substance abuse technically refers to the use of a substance for purposes other than that for which the substance was intended. For example, a medication such as Adderall may be prescribed for the purpose of helping a person who lives with attention deficit or hyperactivity disorder with their capacity to focus. Using the medication in this way does not constitute substance abuse. Using the same prescribed medication, however, for a different purpose than that, that is abuse. Using it to get a euphoric high or to create some extreme state of alertness in one who does not suffer from ADHD, that is abuse. Addiction. The most straightforward definition of addiction is the compulsive continuing use of a substance, even though doing so creates harmful consequences for the user, for the user's network, social network, familial network. Addictions, also called substance abuse disorders in clinical terminology, involve changes in a person's underlying brain pathways as a result of repetitious substance abuse. You're changing your brain when you're doing this. These changes orient the user's desires toward acquisition and use of the substance, initially to bring about the experience of that euphoria, that getting high. And yet, as brain circuitry changes in relation to the repetition of substance use, such desires become even more intense and more narrowly focused. The substance-abusing person requires more of the drug to achieve the same high or just to feel some what they might consider to be their normal baseline of arousal.
That's right. And that's really what we're talking about when we use the term tolerance. Tolerance is one sign that a person is in a situation of being addicted to a substance. Tolerance develops, that means that it requires more of the substance to achieve the same result, or it needs to be taken more often to achieve the same result. There is also the experience of craving that goes along with that. What is a craving? Think about something that you have said, oh, I am craving whatever, pickles and ice cream when you're pregnant. Yeah, I'm craving. You know, the seriousness of, not all cravings are about addiction, but craving in addiction, the serious kind of craving, is an extremely intense, a concentrated kind of desire that is experienced by the person who has it as a need that absolutely must be answered. It cannot go unanswered without causing great suffering. So that creates this sense of compulsion. I've got to have the drug. That creates the compulsion so that the use of the substance then feels more like a need than a want. That's because cravings result from changes in the underlying brain circuitry. And the last piece of this terminology is withdrawal. Eventually, what we refer to as withdrawal symptoms, things like nausea, headaches, anxiety, tremors, eventually these will occur in the absence of the drug, creating another kind of compulsion. I'm not just feeling compelled to use so that I can feel good, I'm also compelled to use so that I will stop feeling bad, so that I can stave off these effects that are happening in my body, in my person, when I do not have access to the substance. Okay, so we have a little activity for you that we're going to set up as a contest. So get somebody at your table to grab, I think you have index card on your table, but a piece of paper is fine, whatever you have there that you can write with, and one person with a pen to be the scribe, okay? And here are the instructions. We are going to give you 30 seconds at your table. Okay, listener, you won't know what to do.
30 seconds.
And there's a prize. You have 30 seconds at your table to see how many different substances of abuse you can get down on that list. The scribe is going to make the list, and we are going to time you. Charles already has his watch at the ready here. Does every table have an appointed scribe? All right, quickly, get your scribe. All right, ready, set, go.
Left. 10 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Stop. All right, who has 10 or more on their list? 10 or more, anybody got 10 or more? Oh, over here, over there. Okay, how about 15 or more? Anybody 15 or more? 12? What are the ones that are sort of the usual suspects, the ones we all are thinking of on your list? A lot of material things you're talking about that people use in order to change their mood. Jewelry, shoes, food, sex, those kind of things. Okay. Okay. What are some of the other things that got onto your list? What are some of the perhaps things you weren't expecting? Coffee. Gambling. Soda. Sugar. All right. Now I want you to think about drugs of abuse. What are some of the ones that showed up on your list?
Reefer.
Acid. Quaaludes. Hash. Mollies. Speed. Alcohol. Whiteout. Whippets. PCP. Okay, if you are not sure about some of these things, you don't know what they are, you don't know about these names, and it seems like another language to you, I would encourage you to go to NIDA, the National Institute of Drug Abuse, online, and there's a very nice publication there that gives you a little quick review of all the different kinds of drugs of abuse that you might want to just know something about. You can read about how they affect people and how they're primarily used. National Institute of Drug Abuse, NIDA, N-I-D-A, online. This is our winning table. 12,
this is the winning table over here.
All right, Skip, you're going to deliver the prize. They get the prize. Woo!
Don't clap too loud. It's candy. It's addictive.
We thought we'd give them sugar since they named sugar as one of their substances, right? Okay. A lot of years ago, when I first began teaching in churches about substance abuse, I would offer a list of commonly observed signs and signals that a young person might be getting into trouble with drugs, and at least one parent in the room would eventually say, "A lot of these behaviors seem like ordinary teenagers. How do I tell the difference? Aren't they all moody? Don't they all want to spend time alone? What's the difference between ordinary adolescents and teenagers who have a substance abusing problem?" There's a handout that we will distribute now. Sarah, you want to help us get that around? That you can take home that has some of these items on it that can help you. What I want you to understand, though, and this is very important, is that if you saw one of these signs in a young person, you do not want to assume that that means that they are abusing drugs. The same sign can be caused by many different things. So a young person can have red eyes because they just broke up with their boyfriend, right? Or they can have red eyes because they've been smoking weed all day. And or they have allergies, absolutely. And so we need to move beyond looking for the one isolated thing that will definitively tell us and think about these in terms of clusters. Are we seeing several of these? Are we concerned for multiple reasons as a way of assessing what might be going on? Because sometimes it is hard to distinguish. We aren't going to go through those because we've got a handout and you can read them and take a look there. We'd be glad to talk further about that when we have some time later for questions.
That's made its way around.
Okay.
So we want to press on. We cannot talk about substance use, substance abuse without at least touching on substance abuse, race, and mass incarceration in America. I would be remiss if I didn't share the perspective on substance abuse and use developed through my 20 years of service as a chaplain in the prison system, where I've seen the consequences of substance use and abuse worsened by the American dimensions of poverty, race, and mass incarceration. So y'all remember when I was talking about Anthony earlier, right? The young man that I introduced, he will soon be released, praise God. Yeah, you can clap for that. I mean, I'm really, I mean, brothers. Simply because, and I'll tell you why I'm good with y'all clapping, because after this long sentence, he will be leaving with a bachelor's degree that he earned from a major university while incarcerated. An obviously intelligent young man, Anthony could not invest in himself with a clear mind until he got serious about his faith, got serious about his education while he was incarcerated. This young man's life experiences reflect the larger societal connection between controlled substances and the American system of incarceration. Things might have been different for him, even with the risky, impulsive behavior he had engaged in, as most teenagers do, when he was caught up with drug use with his peers. But he was from a minority. He was from a minority group. He was from a group that is still considered a minority in this country. And for certain economic classes, the limited options that he had, that they have for legal representation, because of his social economic status, he had limited options for legal representation. He did not know or have access to a more positive community of support, a more positive peer group. He didn't have access to serious adult mentors in his life, adult mentors that I still think about, like I mentioned earlier, Deacon Beverly, right? The consequences of substance abuse are not equally distributed in the lives of young people in the United States. We get that. Whatever young people you work with in your context, an important part of youth ministry needs to be advocacy and connection with young people in the wider societal context in which substance abuse impacts the lives of our treasured young people.
So whether you are working with young people in a situation of privilege or of prison, youth ministers would do well to understand some things about the dynamics of substance abuse and addictions in order to understand those young people who are dealing with these realities. While numerous people use and abuse substances like alcohol, tobacco, caffeine, opioids, marijuana, not everybody develops a substance abuse disorder and addiction. There are a variety of factors that we know contribute to any one individual's proneness to addiction, and those include things like heredity. You have a much greater chance of developing an addiction if someone in your family is an addict. They don't understand yet all the mechanisms of how this gets passed along, but there does seem to be a link. Environmental features like the normalization of substance use in a particular school, in a particular family environment, in a particular peer group. Factors like the societal conditions we've been talking about here, like racism or ableism, that create unlivable conditions while only offering temporary modes of relief from oppressions. Or a person's own internal psychological resilience. These are all factors that play into whether or not a person is prone to substance abuse disorders. I want to say, as we go into talking about the brain, that neither one of us is a neuroscientist. Is there a neuroscientist in the room? I always like to know that when I'm going into this, because we need help, right? We're not. But there are many, many accessible forms of information through which we can come to understand recent developments in neuroscience that give us some important clues. We don't have to be neuroscientists, in other words, to benefit from this new awareness that we have because we know more about brains now. Neurobiologists believe that our brains really are wired to sustain life, to reward behaviors that contribute to our wellness and our wholeness, and that cement the social bonds between us that are necessary for our flourishing. So that's why when we have good social relationships, like if you spend good time with a really good friend, your brain is going ding, 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 sending off dopamine explosions so that you are rewarded for the experience of making a deep connection with somebody. Why? Well, the neurobiologists are telling us that it's part of our internal built-in wiring that we come pre-wired to do the things that are going to nurture us. And we know we need relationships. Same thing happens when you eat. Various other experiences in the human life that contribute to our well-being. This is a kind of biological source of encouragement to repeat those experiences that we have. So at the cellular level, our brains establish an association between a particular activity and the release of dopamine that rewards us for that behavior and its repetition. I like to think about this as the brain's way of anchoring the biological analogs of joy within our very cells. We're so wondrously made by our Creator that our brains are all about joy at the cellular level. That's kind of amazing to me, actually. We are fearfully and wonderfully made. Amen. There is a guy by the name of Daniel Siegel, and he is a psychiatrist who studies the workings of the adolescent brain. He notes that the intense enjoyment of this dopamine surge that happens that tends to promote and reward repetition of a behavior activates the brain's reward system, and that the danger with adolescence is that that can also potentially reward and promote substance use and abuse. What he writes about the dopamine system's relationship to addiction during adolescence is important because he talks about there being, quote, a documented increase in susceptibility to addiction during adolescence to the effects of this increased dopamine release. Listen to what he says. I'm quoting. All behaviors and substances that are addictive involve the release of dopamine. As teens, not only are we more likely to experiment with new experience, also more prone to respond with a robust dopamine release that for some becomes part of an addictive cycle. A drug, alcohol, for example, can lead to the release of dopamine. When the alcohol wears off, our dopamine level plummets. We're then driven to use more of the substance that spiked the dopamine. As with any addiction, he says, we continue to engage in the behavior despite knowing its negative impacts. That is the power of dopamine reward system in the adolescent brain. So think about what this means for adolescent substance use and abuse. With substances of abuse, the built-in joy encourager of the brain's reward system gets all screwed up. The desire to experience these rewards, these good feelings that come from activation of that system, become a powerful driver of behaviors and actions, not the ones that support our flourishing, but ones that are actually harmful to the point of not being able to tell the difference. And at the very same time that's going on, that our brains are especially sensitive to the reward system, the part of the brain that could put the brakes on the whole thing, it's not online yet. It's not working yet, not fully. That's that impulsivity that we talked about earlier, right? It's not there to say, this one might be a little too risky. Let's not do that. That voice is not happening. So drug use comes to take on an enormous significance in a young person's life. And over time, as the reward system gets activated over and over again, those brain pathways actually start changing. They begin to reform in new ways to expect the drug, to expect the use of the substance as a way to get the dopamine level to go up. Because you know what happens. If you drink a lot of water, your body responds by not being thirsty, because it knows that you've already got enough. If you've got dopamine being induced, the firing of those neurons by artificial substances from the outside, the brain thinks, I don't need to make as much of this stuff, because it's going to happen anyway. And so the level drops. What do you think that means for adolescent substance abuse? Anybody got a clue? Yeah, because remember, to get that level to even get the ordinary level of just what feels normal starts to require the use of the substance. Mm. And so that's how this addiction becomes so powerful in the life of a teenager. At that point, there's not much room for anything else. There's not any room to follow God's calling to live in the light of love and joy, to be sure. Here's the real kicker. Because the brain's pathways have been rerouted by substance abuse, this God-given, built-in phenomenon of human desire no longer works like a homing beacon that draws us to God. Instead, it is malformed. It is orienting the young person toward fake joy that is ultimately destructive to them.
All right, I got a little thick, so let's just unpack a little bit with each other. Another table talk time. If you could, please talk to one or two people at your table about what you're hearing and what you're thinking about this information so far. Let's process it together. I know some people are taking notes. Share those notes for just a second. Please come up, if you would, with a single sentence comment that demonstrates your takeaway from this so far, or we invite you to formulate a single question. We wonder about this or that. Report out if you want to share your sentence or your question. We'll be able to take a couple, just a couple tables, if you could. Just process it through. Share what sticks out to you or what question rises from this for you.
They're doing it.
We might be able to do GIFT.
I'm thinking that's not going to happen, but.
All right, let's bring it back. Let's bring it back. We seem to be on time here. So can we hear from a couple of tables? Do you have a comment or a question that sticks out to you about this information?
This is how Skip gets his exercise.
We came up with a single question that we have hopes that you'll be able to answer for us. Can the brain be rewired to bring back the healthy desire for joy?
Wow. Yes. What a lovely question. Let's hear several, and then maybe we could take time to make a response.
Our question is, will medication permanently stop substance abuse?
wanted to, okay, so I have a question coming, but I just wanted to use this as a prop. So we got this great basket of candy. Thank you very much. It's awesome. And had sugar babies in it. And we're like, sugar babies, yeah, these are awesome. So our dopamine receptors are responding.
You bet they are.
Right. And they're like going off right now. Yeah, we got dopamine. But then we run out of these sugar babies. And then maybe we need more sugar babies to get that same feeling back, right? So I guess you brought up an interesting question was, is there something that can replace that? Is there a dopamine replacement generation sort of that maybe could get invented like a pump that you would use like a pain management pump in a hospital, something like that?
And then the second part was, is there an antithesis to dopamine in our systems that we were created with in a natural product in our brain cells that hasn't been discovered yet?
If it hasn't been discovered yet, we probably don't know what to tell you about it, but it's a lovely question.
I know we're speaking, or you're speaking, on the physiological changes in the brain chemistry. But since we are all of faith and Christian faith, I've got to say that in our lives, in our present church, we've had young people that have been addicted for many years, and we have seen the Spirit of God deliver them without help from outside sources. I believe that something happens in the body of Christ when we love on people and when we allow ourselves to be moved by the Spirit of God, because that social connection, I don't know if you know, of course you do, but when you hug someone, there are endorphins released. There are chemical exchanges that happen. When I go up to a sister and I say, hey, God bless you, the Bible says to give a holy kiss. And that affects our emotions. That affects us internally. And that causes adrenaline to be released. That causes serotonin and dopamine to actually be released in the body. So the more we have fellowship with each other, the more we worship and we sing together, the more we act and interact with each other, we produce healing that has nothing to do with what our physiological bodies can or cannot do. The Holy Spirit can do. So I had to say that. And for another note, my brother was an addict for many years. My brother came to Christ. My brother was incarcerated. My brother came to Christ. And the moment he gave his life to Christ, there was no more addiction. So God is able to do what we cannot do.
Why don't we pause and respond to a little bit of this, and we'll see how we're doing for time, and we'll try to pick up some more as we're able. You know, to start at the end there, what you just described was a really important reality that we have been talking about, which is that when we are in community with each other, when we are doing the things that cause us to flourish, we are wired so that the desire that God has for us to do that is manifest in those endorphins, in that dopamine response. So the only piece I would quarrel with is that you're saying, it's not a physical response. It is, but guess what? God made that happen to you. God's the one who makes it so that your endorphins go off when you give Sarah Farmer a hug. All right? And so it's amazing to think about that we come wired for this, and that community is healing, and that is about the Spirit of God at work among us. And that, yes, sometimes people do have these amazing experiences of transformation and recovery, and some people need other ways of assistance. And so the message that I would not want to come out of that wonderful thing that you said, that absolutely wonderful thing that you said, is therefore don't anybody ever seek treatment because God's going to drop it on you. No. Because God works through many, many, many means. including medical people, including nurses and doctors and social workers and counselors and addiction specialists. So I just want to say amen and. That's what I would say there. Let me respond to the question about whether the brain can be rewired. You know, this is a big area of controversy right now in the field of neuroscience, and again, I'm not speaking as a physician or a neuroscientist, but the research that I'm reading says sometimes yes and maybe sometimes no. And here's the thing. Some of the research, for instance, about marijuana use among adolescents seems to be telling us that when these folks become young adults, there is a measurable drop in the IQ score that is not recovered. Because what happens in the brain changes at that level of cognitive capacity, and it doesn't seem to change back. We know of other research that says, well, some stuff does change back because our brains are enormous. We have enormous plasticity in our brains, which means like Play-Doh, right? It takes one form, then it takes another form. It constantly is changing. And so I want to believe that God is at work, that medical science is always improving, that we are, that our brains have so much plasticity that hopefully we do recover that. The way I really know that that happens, though, in my heart is the testimonies of recovering people who tell me that they have lives of joy and who tell me that they figure out ways to do that that don't involve using drugs to induce the fake joy. Will medicine permanently stop substance abuse? There are medications that help with cravings, and they do that. I'm not going to go into the complicated neuroscience of it, but they bind the receptors that make the drug appealing, that make the pleasure sensation happen in the brain. And they bind those so that it's not as pleasurable, so that nothing happens. And so it reduces the craving, and it keeps the person from using enough that they're getting tolerance and withdrawal and all that. And so it makes it possible for them to seek recovery, which is essentially a spiritual matter. Mm-hmm. Without some of those helps, some people can't get there. Some people can. Opioids seem to affect us in a special way that make it harder for our brains to get back without some help. And so you're hearing a lot probably in the news right now about medication as an assistance to drug treatment, especially with opioids. That's what that is about. Something to replace dopamine like a pump. Some people would say we call that prayer in our tradition. I think a lot of addiction and recovery work is really about the intentional seeking out and learning how to utilize things other than the substance in order to get that same kind of feeling. It gets impaired, it gets maladjusted. We hope that we can work on that to bring it back, but a lot of what we do is about that. And it really is about a spirituality of where we attach our desires. Christian faith. Did we get them all? I think we got them. All right. You want to press on? You want to?
Yeah, I think we should press on because we got. I think we should press on because we got a couple more things to cover and a couple more and one final exercise to do, and we're still in time to knock it all out. So we're going to push forward, amen? We cannot be talking about this without dealing with the social context of all this stuff, okay? My wife and I had a baby in December, and as he's developing, I'm reminded of our other kids and how, you know, you have to teach a baby everything. I mean, language, tying shoes, using utensils, you know. So why is it that we don't expect that children need to learn how to filter what society is throwing at them, learn how to figure out what they value, learn what types of friendships are valuable, what types of social networks drain them versus build them up? We have to be intentional about that. And as a youth worker, as a youth minister, I have had to do some uncomfortable things to engage young people where they are, understanding where they are. And I tell you, dealing with things that normalize substance use and substance abuse in popular culture, a lot of us can try and ignore it, just don't turn it on the TV, just turn the radio off, turn to some gospel station, whatever, but the kids are listening to it, hearing it. And we just want to touch on a couple of songs that hit the pop charts last year that we think really will put out there this understanding that, you know, we need to not ignore what our kids are consuming psychologically. This first piece is just going to play a part of it. There's a rapper named Future. He had a hit song last year called Mask Off. Some of you may have heard it. I don't know.
Call it how it is. Hit it. I promise I'm swag. I'm there, bitch. Yo. Percocet. Yeah. Miley Percocet. Percocet. Yeah. Miley Percocet. Represent. Yeah. Gotta represent. Yeah. Dang. Chase a chick, chase. Never chase a no, chase no. Mask on, get mask on, mask on, get mask on, Percocet, Miley Percocet, chase a chick, chase. Never chase a no, chase no. Two cups, toast up with the game, gang, gang. From full stops to a whole nother domain.
Okay. I know we were trying to get into it, I know we're trying to dig into it, but let's just step back. What was the chorus? What was being said? What's the first thing before Percocet? After Percocet. Percocet, Molly Percocet. Everybody know what Molly is? Ecstasy. Thank you very much. So it's Percocet, Molly Percocet. All right. Represent. Got to represent. Mask off. Mask off. Okay. So it's interesting because it's about, you know, mask off, people being real, people being authentic. It's about identity. And in that same message of identity, there's Molly Percocet. Molly Percocet, all right? Like, that's just a part of their identity. That's just a part. You got to know what that is. I'm telling you, I mean, if we were all, you know, 15, 16 years old right now, nobody better not have a misunderstanding about Molly Percocet. You better know what that is. So if that is hitting them regularly, if that's being normalized in their minds, I mean, how do we bring this normal understanding of joy then? What we see as a normal understanding of joy, I mean, does it make you dance? Does it make you head bop? I mean, what are you bringing, Pastor? Right? There's another one. This one is more visual.
We had a lot of choices. We had fun picking these out because we had a lot of choices.
There were a lot of choices out there, man. This was easy. This was the easy part of the presentation. This is Elisa Kyra. Just look at the images.
I guess for now you've got the last command.
It's a house party.
I'm sorry if I seem uninterested. No, I'm not listening. No, I'm indifferent. Truly, I ain't got no business here. But since my friends are here, I just came to kick it. But really, I would rather be at home all by myself, not in this room with people who don't even care about my well-being. I don't dance, don't ask, I don't need a boyfriend. So if you can't go back, please enjoy your party. I'll be here. Somewhere in the corner, under clouds of marijuana, with this boy who's hopping, I can hardly hear. Over this music I don't listen to, and I don't wanna get with you. So tell my friends that I'll be over here. Oh,
Okay. What are some, because, you know, they're all frozen, right? What are some things you see floating in the air? Drugs, smoke, right, from drugs. What else? Alcohol, saw the can in the air, flipped over. This person, yep, people being in the air, that's right. Money, y'all gotta talk about the money now. You saw the money in the air, you're making it rain, right? So we got money, drugs, alcohol, all that's a part of fun. You know, and this, I mean, this artist, she really tries to critique that, offer a critique to that thing, but the fact that she's talking about being dragged to a place where she's with her friends, she had to be there because her friends are there. And she's feeling alone. And so when we're talking about trying to bring our young people to a deeper understanding of joy, we have to understand that we may be asking them to be alone for a little bit. So if you're asking them to be alone or called out, what are you offering instead? Bringing, of course, the importance of the youth group. Right? Where else are they going to go? They got to go somewhere. Were you going to say something, ma'am?
Oh, no, I was going to say, she didn't want to be there.
Right. That's right. That's right. She didn't want to be there. Right?
She had to represent.
Right. Yeah, she had to represent. She had to be there. And she's the only one. I like how this shows here because she's the only one in motion. Everybody else is frozen.
But the sad part is she still went.
Yeah, she still went. How many of our kids are still going? The peer pressure pulls you. And we have to be able to respond to that. We have to acknowledge it, not ignore it. Amen? Mm-hmm. All right. We're moving along great. This is great.
All right. So take a few minutes again at your tables, if you would. What we want you to think about with each other now is how do popular culture and youth and substance abuse come together in your particular context? Take this home, in other words. What kind of interactions do you see with the youth that you care about in your context in relation to substance abuse and various forms of popular culture? Okay?
All right, let's bring it in, let's bring it in. Thank you for jumping into that, and we want those conversations to please continue. Please continue these conversations, and please visit YouTube.
That's right. So what we're really talking about when we entertain this conversation about what's going on in our own context is what matters for youth ministry in relation to the topic of substance use and abuse. And so we want to talk about just a few ideas that we have that are in a very general form that can attach to particular forms of ministry that you develop that are appropriate for your context. We can't give you a bag of tricks that work universally, because you all come from really different situations with different young people. But we can say some things that we see as important in relation to this issue. And the one that comes immediately in relation to the media issue is we need to teach media literacy. And that is, we need to help young people have the skills to unpack what they are hearing so that they become aware, instead of the background noise that isn't even thought about reflectively being Molly Percocet, Percocet, Molly Percocet, we need them to notice that somebody is using drug names as the chorus of a song that becomes the background noise of their reality, maybe the soundtrack of their morning, whatever. So we need to teach those skills that allow them to see what is there and to hear what they're really hearing. Yes.
I was going
to
ask, teaching the skills to the youth.
Yes.
Parents need to be taught the same thing.
That's exactly right.
These kids are playing this music in their houses, and we love it when the fathers don't understand what they're listening to.
Let's be real. All of us need to learn this. What kind of music do you think has the most references to drugs and alcohol?
Rock.
Country Western. Country Western, has the most references to drugs and alcohol.
Wow.
Okay, because every other song is about your mama loves you, even if nobody else does. Mom and Jesus love you, and you're going to drink your beer. Okay? We need, in other words, to pay attention to this noise that is around us and the visuals that are impacting us as well. Another piece for what matters for youth ministry would be that the dynamics of substance abuse being so pervasive in our context becomes an opportunity for us to make our ministries more attentive, more responsive, more compassionate, more understanding of the complex convergence between adolescent development on the one hand, the human yearnings for joy on the other hand, and then inviting young people into a way of life that practices real joy instead of fake joy. So one way to do that is to not only sharpen our own listening skills to try to be aware and attentive to the young people in our midst, but to teach young people how to listen more deeply to each other. Listening is something we learn how to do. We really think we all know how to do it, but we come into the world not necessarily knowing how to sit with somebody and really attend to them. So we need to be teaching that in youth ministry, because when people feel listened to and acknowledged and heard, they feel valued. They feel the embodied experience of that outrageous, unparalleled welcome of God embodied in that listening experience. So we can create workshops, for instance, that teach listening skills. We can build a time for a listening practice into a youth ministry gathering. Being listened to, not superficially, but in a deep, profound, contemplative way, promotes well-being. Another is to strengthen resiliency via some of the tools that we have for self-compassion. Self-compassion, some of the research suggests, is even more important to foster self-compassion than to foster self-esteem. We hear a lot about we've done too much fostering in a false way of self-esteem, give somebody a trophy for putting their shirt on correctly, you know, all that kind of stuff. We've heard the critique of that. What we know about that is that that's not really about self-esteem. Self-compassion, though, is the skill that any of us have, but I'm talking about young people right now, that allows a person to make a mistake and get over it and not let it destroy their ability to love themselves. Mm. So many young people use substances as a way to medicate how awful it feels to be them. Okay? And so teaching people how to be compassionate toward themselves is really important. There's some good resources for this. There is a woman, Dr. Kristen Neff, at the University of Texas at Austin. I'll give you this website, www.self-compassion.org. All kinds of exercises and resources there. What is the great commandment? First of all, love as yourself. If I can't be compassionate to me, chances are I am not going to be compassionate to anybody else. So that's really, really important. A third one would be to help young people with the identification of the values, the hopes, and the gifts that are most important in their lives. Offering ways for young people to identify their core values, these capacities have a preventative role. People in substance abuse treatment talk a lot about how young people with more clearly articulated values have a better time finding that sense of inner compass, the thing inside of us that directs us toward joy, toward all sorts of other things that are important in our lives, to compare with how they live when they're using drugs. And that helps them get back, because they have a back to get to, mm-hmm. right? And so helping young people find the language to articulate those things is an important thing we can do. See Charles Atkins' The New Name Project curriculum. We're going to look at a piece of it in just a moment. Another would be incorporating mindfulness kinds of prayer practices into youth ministry, teaching practices that invite mindful attention to the present moment, to being in the present. You know, we associate that term mindfulness a lot with imported popular culture notions from Buddhism, and it certainly has some grounding there, but you know, Christians also have these practices. We tend to call them things like meditation centering prayer, stillness meditation. Some of you may have prayed mantras in the form of the Jesus prayer or other kinds of focusing, centering practices that invite attention to the now. Christians throughout the centuries have participated in these practices as a way of stilling, of being still and knowing that God is God. Mark Iaconelli's book on contemplative youth ministry is an oldie but a goodie in this area. And the last one I would say is service. Love justice, do kindness, walk humbly with God, also known as get out there and connect with something bigger than yourself that is for somebody else. Research by Emory University neuroscientists James Reiling and Gregory Burns shows that being helpful to somebody else also activates the brain's reward system. So if young people get natural brain candy going by helping other people, then there's less internal motivation to seek it from substance abuse. So service, which is a Christian practice that we're deeply rooted in already, is also a way of participating in equipping young people in relation to this issue of substance abuse.
So, last thing. You're only going to have until the music runs out. I'm going to play some music, and you're going to try and do this. It's one part of the curriculum that's coming with this series on this lecture on substance abuse. It's the third session of for use in a youth group. It deals with what Joyce was talking about in terms of helping a child figure out their values, figure out their worth in the world, right? So you're going to need those index cards. You're going to need your own index card. You're going to need your own pen. The way this works is, what we're going to try and do in a few minutes, you know, you can do with a youth group all summer, okay? For this part, we take the word gift, everyone's unique gift, and we break it down. G, to mean your gifts or talents. I, to be important. What is important to you? F, what are those events that have formed your life, those major events that have formed your life? And T, what are your personality traits? We're not going to deal with all those letters now. I just want to have time for you to think about the F. What serious events, major events, have formed who you are? I want you to all think about the G. What are your gifts, talents? And nobody in here can say you have no gifts or talents. At the very least, you're able to sit down and listen for 2 hours. I mean, everybody has a gift, okay? Everybody has a gift in here, all right? Think about also what is important to you, whether it's family, friends, ministry, you know. But I want you to try and write down what major events have formed who you are. And you should know, you know, something about your own personality traits. I don't want you to take time to write about that, because I want you to think about those things and then try and answer this question. Looking at those major events that have formed who you are and where you are right now, what word or phrase best describes you and what you can give to the world? What word or phrase best describes you and what you can give to the world? Now, normally when I do this, I just do a little survey of hands. How many of you in here before the age of 18 were asked, why are you on earth? Yeah. Before you were 18 years old. That is the same response I get from a group of people, 100 brothers in prison, 100 youth in a youth retreat, educated people, whatever. And it's amazing that that question about purpose in life, when most of us are not asked that seriously before the age of 18, but after 18, we're all punished for it. You know, because what you are and who you are, why you are, determines your type of entertainment, what type of jobs you're running for, working for. And if you mess up in your choices, the world will punish you like you should have known better. But no one has ever asked. So this exercise connects with that, all right? So if you could, just try and think about just the effing gift, what major events have formed who you are right now, and then try to answer that question, what word or phrase best describes you and what you can give to the world? You have until the music runs out. Okay, time's up. So, just know that normally in this exercise, you're really talking it through. You know, the kids have time to really talk about what their gifts are. They really have the time to talk about what's important to them, really get to talk about those major events in their lives. It could have been a divorce, moving out of town, whatever. And then their personality traits, if they're extroverted or introverted. But it all leads up to that final question. What word or phrase best describes not only you, but what you can give to the world? Anybody want to throw some words, some phrases out? Transformed. Transformed. Thank you.
Mentoring.
Mentoring. Thank you.
Creative.
Forgiving. Thank you.
Creativity.
Creativity. All right.
Love.
Thank you. Empathy. Thank you. Give me one more.
Share faith.
Very good, very good. And this is the thing. I love that there's a phrase there. I love that there are words. And this is what you, at this point, this is what you challenge your young people to be able to do. Can someone who's transformed, what type of conversation is a person who's transformed going to have? How is someone who has empathy going to resolve conflict? Where does a person who shares faith hang out? You see, when you give the young people something that they come up with, that they build on, and it's a, like I said, if you look at the curriculum, it's a complicated thing. We're going to walk through. You got to walk through it with them. But you try to get to this conclusion that if I feel that I, that this is who I am right now, this is where I am, and this describes not only who I am, but what I can offer others, then it has to translate into what I do every day. It has to translate into how I move my body in different places, what things I do every day, right? But the thing is, we'll have a great youth group. We'll you know, write these things down, and they'll, you know, if you let them, they'll leave it at the table, they'll walk out. No, you got to take it with you. And the next time we come to the youth group, you can share with us a testimony on how creativity saved the day, how someone who is transformed was able to resolve a conflict. How exactly did you express who you are? And once young people really get to that point of being able to consciously decide the identity that they're expressing, well, then you've taught them how to make some positive relationships, move forward in life in wonderful ways.
We want to thank you for being such a good community of learning and conversation together this evening. It's been very inspiring to listen around the edges of your conversations with each other. We will hang around a little bit in case there are particular questions or if you want to have some more conversation with either one or both of us. And just really appreciate the work that you are doing with young people.
Amen.
The way that you share the love of God.
Thank you.
And the grace of God and the joy.
Thank you.
Of human flourishing in the lives of young people.
Thank
you so very much.
God bless you.